good Wednesday night to everybody. It's good to have you back on here on Facebook and YouTube, and glad we can get together around God's Word again tonight. I want to give you a few thoughts tonight. As you can see, I want to talk tonight about don't forget your destiny. So we're going to be looking in Isaiah chapter number 46 tonight, and I want to kind of continue my thoughts on Joseph. You know, last week we talked about Joseph and his life and how that things kind of were falling apart in his life, but God brought him through it, and God will see us through as well. And if you missed last Wednesday night, I want to encourage you to go back and pick that up. But tonight we're going to look at our text is kind of two verses in Isaiah 46, and it's verses 9 and 10. The Bible says, "Remember the former things of old, for I am God and there is none else. I am God and there is none like me." Boy, isn't that true? "Declaring the end from the beginning and from ancient times the things that are not yet done, saying, my counsel shall stand." And notice what it says at the last phrase. It says, he said, "and I will do all my pleasure." And I was just thinking about that, how God is working about to do his pleasure. You know, we live in a day where it's all about doing our pleasure. It's all about doing what we want to do and having the life we want to have. And we get our plans, all in order. We get our life all planned out. And, God comes along sometimes and says, "Hey, you know what? That's not my will for you. That's not my pleasure. What you're doing, you might be doing it for your pleasure, but you're not doing it for my pleasure. You're not doing it for my glory." And well, we're learning that right now, aren't we, with all this coronavirus, how our lives have completely changed. It's just amazing how life as we know it is so different. And but I'm glad that God has a plan and he's working. He has a destiny for you and he has a destiny for me. You know, Joseph, here he was. He was separated from his loved ones. He was experiencing social distancing before it was a thing, you know. And but God was working all along to bring about his destiny. And we're going to use that word a lot tonight, destiny, because I want that to really burn in your heart. And I want you to think about this. The Bible has a lot to say about destiny. Again, as you can see here, God is saying in Isaiah, he says, "Listen, my counsel will stand." In other words, what I have determined is going to happen. And he says, "I will do all my pleasure." Or you could say it this way, "I will fulfill my destiny for you in your life." Now think about that. Now, that's not the only place it talks about destiny. Over in Habakkuk chapter number 2 and verse number 2, the Bible says this. It says, "And the Lord answered me and said, write the vision and make it plain upon tables, that he may run that readeth it." Now look at verse number 3. It says, "For the vision is yet for an appointed time." In other words, it's not yet, but the vision is going to come. Why? Because I've got a plan. I've got a destiny that I'm working on. It says, "But at the end, it shall speak." In other words, it's going to happen and not lie. "Though it tarry, wait for it." Here it is, because it will surely come and it will not tarry. So God is telling Habakkuk, he says, "Listen, I've got a vision that I want you to write down, and I want you to make it plain. I want you to put it on tables. I want you to make sure people get this, because it's something that's going to happen at the appointed time. It's a destiny I have for you, Habakkuk." And he said, "It will surely come and will not tarry." Boy, isn't that great? Aren't you glad God's got a destiny for us, something he's working out? But get this, not only do we have a destiny, but God's word says the Bible even has a destiny. Now, what do you mean by that? Well, the Bible says in Isaiah 55 and verse 11, "So shall my word be that goeth forth out of my mouth. It shall not return unto me void or empty, but it shall accomplish that which I please, and it shall prosper in the thing whereunto I sent it." So God says, "I've got a destiny for my word. I've got a purpose for my word that every time it's preached." You know what? That even means tonight. That means on a Wednesday night, here in my house, under quarantine, if you will, in a situation like we're facing, the word of God right now is going out, even if it's going out on Facebook and YouTube and these other social platforms, the word of God's going out. And so the Bible says, God said that I've got a destiny for my word, that when it goes out, it's going to accomplish something. You know why the word of God always accomplishes something? Because it's got power. It is alive. It's not dead. It's alive. And so what I want to get across to you tonight for the next few minutes is even though we're in the midst of this chaos and all the things that are going on in our lives, God's destiny for you has never changed. It's still the same. And God's still working even through this to fulfill his plan for your life. And so I want you to understand, God has prepared a destiny for you. He's prepared a destiny for you. You realize that from the moment you were born, and God has a plan. When you got saved, God has got that plan. He's working in your life. He put the Holy Spirit in you, and he begins to prepare a plan. In fact, in Philippians 1 and verse 6, Paul said, being confident of this very thing. In other words, we can be sure about this, that he which hath begun a good work in you. Do you know that when you got saved, he began a good work in you? He began a destiny, if you will, bringing you to a destination. And I'm not just talking about heaven. I'm talking about his purpose for you in this world. So God has prepared a destiny for you. But it also says that God has prepared he will perform that destiny through you. God will perform that destiny through you. Now, notice what it says here in Philippians 1:6. He will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. Until the day when he comes, he's going to keep performing that in you. Now, the Lord has not come yet, right? The rapture has not taken place yet. So that means he's still got a destiny he's going to perform. So let's look at some people that God had a destiny for. We were still talking about Joseph, and as you saw just a moment ago here, it says, number one, Joseph was destined to be a ruler. Destined to be a ruler. Now, what do you mean by that? Well, God had a destiny for Joseph all along, and Joseph knew it. He didn't really know maybe how God was going to work it out. He didn't understand how it was all going to come to pass. But Joseph knew that God had a destiny for him that was more than where he was at right then. In fact, Joseph was put in the pit, but he knew he was destined for a palace. He was put into a prison, but he was destined for a palace. And, you know, while others would have cried in the pit, others would have caved in the prison, but Joseph all along knew that that wasn't his final destination. Joseph, when he was in that pit, he didn't like the pit. I'm sure it was an uncomfortable pit. It was not a place you wanted to be. Going to prison wasn't a great place. It was a tough place to be. But you know what? In the pit and in the prison, Joseph always knew that this is not my final destination. That this is not all that God has for me. He's already put in me a destiny for greater things. And so what I want you to think about tonight is, again, don't let this circumstance that we're in depress you and discourage you. God has a destiny for you. He's got a final destination. He's working in your life to be more and more like Jesus Christ. And he's not going to stop that until he comes, until he takes you on or takes me on. And so don't let your today cause you to forget your tomorrow. See, don't let what's going on in your life today cause you to forget that God's got a greater destiny for you down the road. And I believe he's still got work that he wants us to do, right? And so Joseph realized, and here's the key, I think, to Joseph being able to survive the pit and survive the prison is because he knew that even when he was in the pit, his life was more than a pit. Even when he was put into prison, his life was more than a prison. He knew that his life is not what his circumstances dictated. His circumstances didn't dictate his life. God's destiny did. And so your life this evening, we're all kind of in this thing together. But, you know, your life is more than a quarantine. Your life is more than a lost job. Your life is more than a sick body that you might have right now. You have a God-given destiny. Isn't that great? Isn't that exciting? Now listen, the truth about the matter is, before Joseph could ever get to the palace, he had to endure the pit. Before he could get to the palace, he had to endure the prison. That was steps along the way that God had to grow Joseph in the trials and bring him to that destiny. So let's go to the second person. Who's another person in the Bible that had to experience a destiny and think about that? Well, the second person is David. David was destined to be a king. Now you think about this. As a young boy, here he was. He went down to the Valley of Elah, and there he heard this big old ugly giant named Goliath, who was just thundering out cursings and vile language and just cursing and blaspheming the God of Israel. And David looked around. He said, is somebody not going to take care of Goliath? I mean, who's going to go down there and fight this Philistine? And of course, everybody just laughed at David and said, you just don't understand. Man, look how big he is. Nobody can go down there and fight him. And David said, I'll go fight him. I'll take him on. Because he knew it wasn't just him. It was the Spirit of the Lord that would work with him. And so David went down there, but you know what? David, now, it took a lot of courage. It took a lot of courage for David to go up and fight Goliath, no doubt. But you realize that by the time David went to the Valley of Elah, before he ever picked up the sling, before he ever picked up five smooth stones, he had already been anointed king. He had already had this destiny placed on him. And so while he went down there, he didn't know for sure what God was going to do, but he believed he knew what God was going to do. And he said, I believe God is going to deliver this Philistine into my hand. Why? Because God's given me a destiny. He's already called me to be king. He's already anointed me to be king. And so if God allows this giant to kill me, then God's either going to have to raise me up from the dead, or he wasn't telling the truth to begin with, because I'm going to be king one way or another, because God said it. And see, God has a destiny for you and I. And so whatever circumstances you or I are in, those, listen, they don't have to kill us. They might be a giant in our lives, but we're not living according to the giant. We're living according to the destiny that God's got for us in our lives. And so just like Joseph, David knew what it was like to be in a pit. Now, he wasn't in a pit of dirt, but he became in a pit of despair. Over time, he had many enemies that came up against him. Even his own son, Absalom, come against him. And he knew what it was like to be in a pit of despair, but he also knew that that pit was not his destiny. Look what it says in Psalm chapter number 40 and verse number 2. David said, he brought me up also out of a horrible pit. He knew that pit experience. Out of the miry clay, and he set my feet upon a rock and established my goings. And he has put a new song in my mouth, even praise unto our God. Many shall see it and fear and shall trust in the Lord. And so here, David said, man, I feel like I'm in a pit of circumstances that I can't get out of. I mean, he said, man, he likened it to a miry clay that's just slippery. And it's like you try to take one step forward and you slide two steps backward. Have you ever been like that in your life? And he said, I just don't understand these circumstances. But he said, I believe that God is going to work in these circumstances. And he said, he brought me up out of this horrible pit. You know why? Because he said, this pit is not my destiny. This pit does not have to control me. This pit does not have to destroy me. And so, see, here he begins to praise God. He said, he put a new song in my mouth. He said, he put praise in my mouth. Now, how in the world, David, can you praise while in the pit? I'll tell you, you can praise while you're still in the pit when you remember your purpose is beyond that pit, when you realize that's not all God has for you. Well, let's look at the third person really quick. And the third person that had a destiny is Jeremiah. He was destined to be a prophet. Now, Jeremiah is like a lot of us sometimes. Jeremiah really struggled with depression. He battled depression and a lot of the attacks from the enemy, spiritual warfare. And boy, we see that a lot today, don't we? And he struggled. You know why? Because Jeremiah, like us, Jeremiah struggled with seeing what God was trying to do in his life. You know, it'd be a whole lot easier if we just knew how everything was going to end. It'd just be greater if we knew what all God was doing in our lives, but we don't. We don't always see the end from the beginning because we're not God. That's where trust comes in. That's where faith comes in. And so he struggled to see what God was doing, but nevertheless, even when he struggled, even when he was discouraged, even when he was attacked, even when he got depressed, God still had a destiny he was working in Jeremiah's life. In fact, look what God said to Jeremiah in Jeremiah chapter number 1 and verse 4. The Bible says, "Then the word of the Lord came unto me, saying, Before I formed thee in the belly, I knew thee. And before thou camest forth out of the womb, I sanctified thee. And I ordained thee a prophet unto the nations." Oh, get that. Look at that. He says, "I formed thee." I mean, he was there at the very, very beginning. He said, "Jeremiah, you don't have to worry about what's going to happen to you, because I was the one that formed you." And then not only that, it says, "I knew thee." And then not only that, it says, "I sanctified thee and I ordained thee." Do you see how God is working this destiny in Jeremiah's life? He said, "You don't have to worry about all this." And then said I, he said, "Ah, Lord God, behold, I cannot speak, for I am but a child." And then look what God said next. In the next verse, it says, "But the Lord said unto me, Say not, I am a child, for thou shalt go to all that I shall send thee, and whatsoever command thee, thou shalt speak." What's that? That's a destiny. That's the purpose. That's a plan. God says, "I've got something more for you than where you're at right now. You're being attacked right now. You're being discouraged right now." He says, "But you're not going to stay here. I'm going to send you somewhere." And he said, "I'm going to have you speak on my behalf." Then look what it says in the last part. "Be not afraid of their faces." Boy, some of us preachers can use that sometimes now preaching. Sometimes you can preach out at the congregation and you see some faces looking back at you. And he said, "Don't be afraid of their faces, for I am with thee," look at this, "to deliver thee, saith the Lord." He said, "Listen, you're going to face some difficult circumstances, but because I've got a destiny plan for you, I've got a purpose, I'm still working in your life," he said, "I'm going to deliver you. I'm going to take care of you." Oh, you don't need to. So listen, you may not see God's destiny in your life right now, but that's not stopping God from working in your life. He's still working right now, even in these difficult circumstances. Hey, there's a fourth destiny we see in the Bible too, a fourth person, and we all know this one, and that is Jesus. Number four, Jesus was destined to be our Savior. Boy, isn't that great? You know, when Jesus came here and he was born of a virgin, he wasn't coming to start a cult or a clique or anything else. He came for one purpose, and that was his destiny. What was the destiny of Jesus? Well, we find it in Matthew 1:21, "And she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus." Here's his destiny: "For he shall save his people from their sins." And so Jesus also had a destiny. He came to die for our sins. Now, you might be watching this video. Maybe you come across it on YouTube or on Facebook, or somebody shared it or invited you to watch. And you don't know Jesus Christ as your Savior. Do you know that he died for you? He died to save you. That was his destiny. He came to die on the cross to pay for your sin and my sin so that you and I wouldn't have to die and go to hell. Wasn't that great? And so Jesus was destined to be our Savior. But let me give you the last one, because I want to bring it back to us now. And that is number five, we are destined to overcome. We're destined to overcome. Now listen, sometimes we can allow our circumstances to overcome us, but we really have the power to overcome our circumstances. Now, look what the Bible says in John chapter number 16 and verse number 32. John chapter number 16, verse number 32. It says, "Behold, the hour cometh, yea, is now come, that ye shall be scattered, every man to his own." That kind of sounds like us, doesn't it? He says, there's the hour is going to come. He told these disciples that you're going to be quarantined. You're going to be scattered. You're going to be separated, if you will. There's going to be some social distancing take place here. And he said, "You're going to be scattered, every man to his own, and shall leave me alone. And yet I am not alone, because the Father is with me." Boy, isn't that interesting? Jesus said, he said, the time is going to come when people are going to come after me, and you're going to run everywhere. You're going to be scattered out of fear. You're going to leave me alone. You're going to leave me high and dry. Have you ever felt like that before? Have you ever felt like those that you just knew were your friends? You just knew they were going to stand with you through thick and thicker. You just knew it. But boy, when that trial came, they were the first ones out the door. Jesus said, some of my closest people, the friends and disciples that I spent time investing in, He said, there's going to come a time you're all going to be scattered and you're going to run in every direction, leaving me alone. But then look what he says. But he said, really, I'm not alone because the Father is with me. Can I say this? Listen, you might have had people forsake you. You might have lost your job through this ordeal. You might have lost your health through this ordeal. And you might feel like everything has forsaken you. Can I tell you, you're still not alone. Oh, no, if you're saved, if you know the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior, you are not alone. The Father is still with you. Praise God. Isn't that a blessing? Isn't that interesting? And then look what it says in verse number 33. These things have I spoken unto you, that in me ye might have peace. We're not going to have peace in the world. We're not going to have peace in the circumstances. Our peace must be in Christ. Look what it says. In the world ye shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. He has, hasn't he? He's overcome. When he rose from the dead, he overcame death. That's a whole lot greater power than this virus we're facing. And so if he overcome death, he can overcome what we're going through, right? And so I want to challenge you tonight as I close that, listen, don't get discouraged where we're at. God is working his destiny in you. Now, two quick thoughts I want to leave you with, and that's this. God picked you. God picked you. Remember, I preached on Sunday on for such a time as this. If you didn't get a chance to hear that message, go back and look at that and watch it. God has you and God has me for such a time as this. He picked you to do what he wants to do in your life. Isn't that great? In fact, the Bible says in John 15:16, Jesus said, you have not chosen me, but I have chosen you. Now, I'm telling you, listen, you might not feel like much. You might feel like a discouraged, depressed Jeremiah. You might feel like a Joseph in a pit. You might feel like a King David when he's down in that pit of despair. But I'm telling you, God has a destiny for you, and he picked you. Not only did God pick you, but then also notice that God placed you. Look what it says next. He says, I have chosen you and ordained you that you should go and bring forth fruit. You know what God wants you to do during this time? He wants you to bear fruit. Keep bringing fruit. Well, I've been blessed to hear of people who've been saved during this time. A preacher friend of mine was just talking on Facebook just this morning about someone that pulled up and got out and was talking about how God has used these circumstances to wake them up spiritually. Boy, isn't that great? What a blessing that is. And so, listen, don't give up. Don't quit. He has picked you and he has placed you. He's put you at a place of influence in other people's lives, even if you're not in the same room with them. You can influence them, or the phone, through Facebook, whatever it is. Just be who God made you to be. Don't let the circumstances rob you of your God-given destiny. Don't forget, in all of this, God's got a destiny. As long as you have breath in your lungs, God has a purpose for you. Well, I sure hope this has been an encouragement to you tonight. And don't forget, if you will, to like and comment. And please share this video. The more shares we get out, the more people will get to hear God's word and encourage them, and maybe somebody else might be saved. Well, Lord bless you, and until we see you on Sunday morning, have a great night.